Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Health and Sport Committee in the Scottish Parliament's 5th session. I would ask everyone in the room to ensure their mobile phones are silent. Of course, it's acceptable to use mobile devices for social media, but please don't take photographs or film proceedings. The first item on the agenda is an evidence session on the Audit Scotland Report NHS in Scotland 2016. Can I welcome to the committee Shona Robinson, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport, and Paul Gray, Director General Health and Social Care and Chief Executive of NHS Scotland. Welcome to the committee. Could I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement?
Okay, well, thank you very much, Convener. As I made clear in my parliamentary statement last week, the Audit Scotland report has provided a balanced overview of the NHS and makes several recommendations which we accept in full. I welcome a further opportunity to discuss the report this morning. Our investment and achievements are recognised in the report. Funding is at a record high of close to £13 billion. Staffing is at its highest ever level. And health, patient safety and survival rates are all showing improvements. But as I highlighted last week, to equip our health and social care services for the future, we must reform as well as invest. We recognise the demands and pressures, and that's why we'll continue to drive forward our significant programme of transformational change. By the end of this year, we'll set out a transformational change delivery plan for the integration of health and social care, the National Clinical Strategy, the Public Health Strategy, realistic medicine, workforce recruitment, supporting population health and meeting the 2020 vision. Audit Scotland highlights that we need to make a real shift from relying on treating people in hospital to supporting people with better care in their own homes and communities. And that's what we intend to do. Over the course of this Parliament, we will increase health spending by almost £2 billion and we'll invest an additional £500 million in primary care. That will let us see for the first time ever half of the health budget spent in the community, delivering primary, community and social care. The committee will also be aware that we're investing £200 million in elective and diagnostic treatment centres to address the changing demographics of our nation over the next 20 years, particularly in meeting the likely increase in our elderly population. It's important that we focus on outcomes for patients and that the mechanisms we use to measure performance better reflect these outcomes. Our arrangements for a review, chaired by Sir Harry Burns, will ensure that our targets and performance indicators lead to the best outcomes for people being cared for, whether in hospital, primary care, community care or social care. Convener, Audit Scotland are supportive of our transformational change plan. It's now important that we work together across Parliament and with our colleagues in health boards and local government to make that happen. It's through this approach of continued investment and reform that will set the basis for delivering the 2020 vision and our longer-term strategy up to 2030. That will ensure a safe, sustainable and person-centred NHS for the people of Scotland.
Thanks very much. Could I ask any of my colleagues if they wish to open the questions? Alison.
Yes, if I might start. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The committee is aware of your proposal to present the plan to bring about this transformational change by the end of this year. The Audit Scotland report has said that it's not clear yet what number and levels of staff will be required until further work is done on testing new models and a clearer plan is in place. It points out that the workforce implementation plan that the government has published is high level and doesn't outline the workforce requirements to deliver the 2020 vision and the National Clinical Strategy. And the committee recently heard from the Royal College of Midwives, who said that the NHS is running a third test of its workforce planning tools for midwives, and that if it's having a third test to run the tool, it cannot tell me that the tool is robust. The Royal College of Midwives also suggested that some previous workforce planning had been done in isolation by boards without getting the input from professionals on the ground. So I'd just be grateful if the Cabinet Secretary could tell the committee what is happening at the moment to develop this workforce plan with all of those that we've heard evidence from.
Well, we very much want to involve all of the stakeholders that you mentioned and others in the development of both the regional and the national workforce plan. I mean, workforce planning has been a key part of the NHS for a long time, but it has tended to be at board level. And we've obviously worked with boards to make sure that they land their workforce plans as accurate as possible. But what we do recognise is that we need to take a regional and national approach to workforce planning in a way that we haven't previously done, and that's a new part. That, of course, can't sit in isolation, which is why the delivery plan that I've talked about this morning and the Audit Scotland talked about was that you have to bring all the strands together. You can't just look at workforce in isolation. That has to be overlaid by the financial plan, the national clinical strategy, realistic medicine. It's about bringing all of those elements together in a coherent way that will set out for the next 5, 10, 15 years what is required to make some of those changes. So, for example, in the workforce plan, a key part of that will be what's the primary care workforce that's going to be required to make that shift. That's not just about GPs, it's also about advanced nurse practitioners, it's about allied health professionals, bringing all of that together in order to make sure that the workforce, some of those which will be new roles, I suspect, as we go forward, is there in sufficient numbers as we move and shift the balance of care across. So that's, I guess, what the new part of this is. It's almost, I would say as well, it's almost as much of an art as a science to get workforce planning accurate, because things change and you may have a workforce plan, a board may have a workforce plan that it thought was robust, but then, you know, the needs of their local population can change and they can find that they need to make changes to that workforce plan, which is why the regional and national approach is right, because we can project as far as we can about what those changing needs are going to be and what the workforce requirements will be, particularly, as I say, in primary care.
Donald McCaskill, the Chief Executive of Scottish Care, told the committee that the vacancy level for social care nurses has now reached 28%. And I appreciate what you're saying about the government perhaps having a sort of wider vision about, you know, which professional vacancies we need to fill. So is it the case that there's going to be greater national direction on previously non-controlled subjects?
I think there will need to be greater national and regional direction than perhaps there was previously. Obviously, social care is, again, more complex because in the case of care at home, you obviously have local government as the employer. So through our integrated plans, through the IGBs, that workforce requirements across health and social care will need to be integrated. So it's not just about health, it's about the social care dimension as well. In terms of nursing homes and the nursing component, I know the RCN have raised concerns. It's always been a difficult area to recruit to for a variety of reasons. We are keen to work with the RCN to look at whether we can enhance the career opportunities that may exist for nurses working in nursing homes that could take advantage of career, of training opportunities and career development within the NHS. So we need to look at more imaginative ways of trying to encourage nurses into the nursing home sector if we're going to stabilise that.
Can I ask one quick question, convener? Jill Vickerman of the BMA last week expressed concern about the way that vacancies are currently recorded. So in order to fully understand what vacancies exist, would it not be more sensible to include posts that are currently being filled by locums or posts that have been advertised and no longer are? I mean, I think Jill Vickerman made the point that if staff on a ward, for example, know that there are actually 10 vacancies but only 3 are currently being advertised, then that has an impact on morale. And how can we possibly, I just think a clearer system would be appreciated by all.
I understand the point Jill Vickerman is making. There's obviously been a standardised way of recording vacancies. I understand the point that she and others have made. We, in addition to the work on and trying to fill vacancies, and some of that is very challenging, not just a Scottish problem, but in some specialties very much a UK and international problem. And a lot of work is going on to try and attract people to those posts, making the posts more attractive across more than one site, and all of that work. However, what we're also doing is looking at whether or not posts that are continually filled through locum and agency can be dealt with in a different way, or perhaps certainly in the case of agency, some of that is being dealt with through the work of the CNO and looking at converting some of that agency spend into substantive posts themselves, rather than relying on agency and back nurses. If a shift rotor is in a hospital is continually using a high level of agency nursing, then an analysis of that may determine that actually the better thing to do is to convert that into a substantive post. So those discussions are going on as well. That's more difficult in locum in terms of medical posts. We do have the medical bank, which tries to help with short-term vacancies, but that is a bit more challenging. But again, we're happy to speak to Jill Vickerman and others about how we take that forward and in our workforce plans, and we'll listen to what they have to say.
Okay, Tom, then Alex.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Good morning. My question is really just as a supplementary to Alison Johnson's in regards to workforce planning, and it's to ask what impact Brexit has had upon the deliberations and the work underway as regards workforce planning. And in particular, given the UK government's failure to assure the status of EU nationals and indeed describing EU nationals as bargaining chips, I wonder if any contingencies are being factored into workforce planning in the event we do have a hard Brexit.
Well, obviously this afternoon's debate is going to look at these issues in more detail. There are concerns, obviously, about the impact on particularly our medical nursing workforce, the medical doctors. Currently there's about 6.8%, I think, of doctors have EU status, which means that if we weren't able to retain those doctors working here in Scotland, that would be a significant dent in the workforce. We want them to continue to work here, as well as the nurses and the social care workforce that have come to work, to train and work here in Scotland, and we very much value them. One of the things we have made a commitment to is to give reassurance to students already studying, those about to begin their studies here and those applying to study here from 2017-18, that they'll continue to enjoy free tuition for the duration of their studies at our medical and dental schools. Unfortunately, the bit we can't provide assurance on is about the future rights to remain here to train and work, and this could impact on their future career decisions when they're deciding where it is that they want to go. So it is an important issue, part of the negotiations, and we'll have more to say about that later today. But I think it's important that the key message is we very much value the contribution that they already make within our health and care services.
Alex.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet morning. Secretary. Thank you for coming to us this morning. The Audit Scotland report, obviously, was quite uncomfortable reading for all of us who have a stake in the healthcare profession. But the government did meet one target, and that was in the treatment of drug and alcohol cases, particularly at the acute end, and I congratulate it for that. But I would suggest that perhaps this is a case of what the government gives with one hand, it takes away with the other. We heard last month from Robin McCulloch-Graham, who is the chair of the Integrated Joint Board of Edinburgh, that the impact of the 22% cut to alcohol and drug partnership funding in the last Scottish Government budget would be measured out as a 1.3 million year-on-year loss to services in the drug and alcohol field in Edinburgh alone. That is, to my mind, a fire sale, and we will see the impact of that over not just years but decades in not just Edinburgh but everywhere in Scotland where drug and alcohol misuse is a problem. We've seen a measurable rise in HIV cases in Glasgow already, and I just want to ask the Cabinet Secretary to give us her reflections on the Audit Scotland report and the fact that whilst we may be meeting the acute treatment targets on drug and alcohol misuse, that we will be messing up the end game.
If I could just make a overall comment, firstly about the targets. And obviously, it's important to say that the cancer, the 31-day cancer target was only missed by about 0.1%, which still are people. It's about eight patients in total. And we have to strive to do better than that. But I think Audit Scotland put that in some context. Also on outpatients, I recognise we have a challenge on outpatients, and that's why we're bringing forward a programme of additional investment in outpatients, but importantly a transformation programme in outpatients, because we need to better manage the outpatient capacity. On alcohol and drug partnership funding, you'll be aware that we also wrote to boards asking them to support the funding levels of ADPs. Some have, some haven't, and we'll continue to work and discuss with those boards how we make sure that the outcomes, which is what is really important here, that the outcomes of delivery of alcohol and drug outcomes continue to be as good as they are. In fact, many partnerships have well over-delivered what they were asked to deliver, which is a good thing. And have delivered a very, very high level of performance. And there has been a substantial investment in alcohol and drug funding. What we've also said is that we need to review what the priorities and have a look at the performance more generally of ADPs, and how we may want to discuss with ADP some of the some changes that they may wish to make, and to focus on the outcomes for the next period of time. So, as I said, I think I've said in this committee before, we'll continue to talk to boards about ADP funding. We'll continue to look at what ADPs do, and we'll continue to look at what the outcomes are, and make sure that they are in a position to deliver those outcomes.
Okay, thank you. I'm grateful for your answer, and certainly encouraged to hear that this is still very much on your radar. However, 22% as a cut in the overall budget to alcohol and drug partnerships can only lead to a withdrawal of service in some areas, as we are seeing in Edinburgh. It's fine for you to go to the local health boards and the integrated joint boards and say, make this money up somehow. It's a very different thing to actually make that materialise on the ground. With that loss of service, we will see undoubtedly see a proliferation and drug and alcohol misuse or long-term addictions going untreated, which I think will then have a material impact on those treatment targets that we see. If we see an increase in demand for acute treatment targets in treatment, then those targets will be missed in the future. Can the Cabinet Secretary explain to us the reasoning behind the original cut to the 22% in ADP from the Scottish budget last time?
Well, The budget was an amalgamation of health and justice funding, as I'm sure you're aware. To just put a bit of context, though, I mean, as a government, we have invested over £630 million to tackle alcohol and drug use since 2008, so it has been a significant investment. We did make clear to boards that we expect the outcomes to still be met, and that they will require to ensure that happens. Now, we suggested that boards should maintain the level of funding through their own resources, and of course boards have been given above inflation increases this financial year, but however they do it, we still will require ADPs, with the support of boards, to meet their outcomes. Now, part of that is the review, and we've been that review is underway with key stakeholders, looking at how we support them to do that. There may be some need to focus some of the ADPs more around those outcomes. ADPs are very varied in what they do and how they operate. I think we need to bring maybe a bit more of a standardisation to that. But I suppose the bottom line is this, outcomes matter. The funding is important, but what matters is the outcomes for that funding. We've been clear that those outcomes still require to be delivered. Now, that will either be through the level of funding that they have allocated, and if they can do that with the funding they have and deliver the same outcomes by doing things in a different way, then we'll look at that. If not, then we would require and expect boards to support the ADPs in delivering those outcomes, but the outcomes still require to be delivered.
Everybody around this table would absolutely agree that the outcomes matter and the outcomes still need to be delivered, but this Cabinet Secretary has the feeling of a Premiership football manager still telling its team to deliver the same result when three players have been sent off the pitch. That's what we're talking about here. We're talking about a 22% loss in resources, and I don't think, with respect, you answered my question as to why the government felt it was okay to withdraw that 22% of funding.
Well, we have asked boards to essentially support that funding at the same level as previously. The budget was an amalgamation of health and justice resources, and we've asked boards to supplement the funding. But if you look at the outcomes, which again are the most important, the funding is important, but it's actually what's delivered for the funding. Waiting times have been hugely reduced, with 94% of people now being seen within 3 weeks of being referred, routinely meeting the national 90% within 3 weeks local delivery plan standard. Drug taking in the general population is falling. I think in the light of all of that information, and it's important that ADPs look at delivering their existing outcomes, but also what the outcomes should be going forward. And as part of the review of targets and indicators more generally, what it is that we think ADPs and the ADPs think they should be focusing on over the next period of time. In the light of some of that shift in behaviour, there are still challenges, particularly among some of the older population. So we need to make sure that the substantial resources that are still going into drug and alcohol are delivering the right things, and perhaps refocusing on where the biggest problems still remain in the light of some of that population behaviour change, which is, of course, something that's a good thing.
Cabinet Secretary, we've heard several times this morning that outcomes matter. According to the report, there's a funding crisis. There are workforce problems impacting on patient care, agency use up, vacancy rates up, and 7 of the 8 key targets or outcomes are being missed. If outcomes matter, then we have a problem. How can it be, if 7 out of the 8 targets are being missed, that further budget reductions are being regarded as efficiencies?
Well, I'm sure...
Could I direct that to Mr. Gray first? Mr. Gray is the senior official with the NHS in Scotland, and obviously you're responsible, along with the Cabinet Secretary, for... you're accountable for this, so that's why I wanted to bring you in.
Okay, so... efficiency savings have been delivered year on year by the NHS in Scotland. That is not a new proposition. I'm not clear, just so that I answer your question appropriately, Mr. Finlay, what are you referring to specifically as budget reductions? The budget has gone up each year.
Well, if we look at different boards, they are telling us that they are making very significant... I don't want to always harp on about Lothian, but NHS Lothian is something like £68 million this year of reductions. Now, if you're missing 7 out of 8 targets already, and you're required over the next 4 years to bring in another £300 to £400 million, how on earth can they be called efficiencies?
Because we look to boards to transform their services in order to deliver them more efficiently and to improve the outcomes that they deliver. NHS Lothian, and this is from memory, and I'll be happy to provide it with accuracy to the committee if I've made a mistake, I think NHS Lothian's uplift was 6.4%. So they did have a funding uplift. We also put in extra money to Lothian over the last 2 years to bring them closer to NRAC parity. And I don't think it's unreasonable for the public to expect that the NHS in Scotland becomes more efficient year on year. But that's why the programme of transformational change that we have in train is so important. The further detail that the Cabinet Secretary will provide to the Parliament by the end of the year, and I've also undertaken to write to the Audit Committee by the end of the year, confirming our framework for change as requested in Audit Scotland's report on transforming models of health and social care. So I don't think it's unreasonable to ask boards to make efficiency savings, and their budgets have not been cut. I'm happy to say something about the 8 targets if that would be helpful.
We may come to that, but the almost every witness that's come before us has raised issues about cuts to services. The only people that I hear of who are saying there are no cuts to services are senior managers in the NHS. And if we have the highest level of investment, as has been stated, in the NHS, would you regard this report as a glowing endorsement of the management of that record investment?
I'm not after glowing endorsements, Mr. Finlay. I think this is a balanced report, as the Cabinet Secretary has said. And I, as the Cabinet Secretary has also said, we've accepted its recommendations. Among these recommendations are the importance of sustained transformational change. I think that's fundamental to delivering a safe, person-centred and effective health service.
Final point I'll make is, and what comment would you have to those patients who have been waiting longer for treatment than they should, because 7 out of those 8 targets have been missed?
I apologise to patients who wait longer than they should. I have done so in the past. I regard it as appropriate and proper that I should do so. It is not what we seek, that patients should wait longer than the targets that we have set. But if I may say on the 8 targets, we are, as far as I can determine, and I have done some research, we are the only country in the world that tries to meet all 8 of these targets. I'm happy to have stretch aims. I believe it's part of our approach to improvement to have these aims and to be doing all that we can to transform in view of meeting the stretch aims that we've set ourselves. The Cabinet Secretary has referred to Sir Harry Burns' review. I think it's the right point at which to review whether all of the targets we have are delivering the outcomes that we want. But in the meantime, if we're not achieving what we said we would achieve, then I apologise to those who have not been seen within the time.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, can I just make the point that obviously in the election we were elected on a manifesto commitment to increase the health revenue budget by £500 million more than inflation by the end of this parliament. That was higher than any other party put forward. So no matter who is in power in this government and putting forward a prospectus in this parliament, it is against a backdrop of increasing funding but increasing demands. If you look at the outpatient demands, for example, increasing over the years, despite those huge increases in demands, the performance is still the fact most people are still being treated within the 12-week target for a first outpatient consultation. Also, in terms of inpatient waits, 91.2% of inpatients were treated within the 12-week treatment time guarantee for quarter two of this year. Now, that isn't good enough. We want everybody to be treated quickly. But I think it's important to make the point that the vast majority of patients are still treated quickly within the NHS. What we need to do is to make sure that through our transformation programme we improve that performance in a sustainable way. Partly that will be done through, for example, our outpatient transformation work. Our outpatient system is not the most efficient that it could be. We need to make sure the capacity is used as effectively as it can be. But also the work of Sir Harry Burns, and there has been political consensus for many years around this. In fact, I think the spokespeople of all of the political parties over the years have at one point or another said that we need to make sure that what we measure in terms of patient outcomes more accurately reflects the patient experience. Sometimes our targets are more input-based than about outcomes. I accept that criticism, and that's why I've asked Sir Harry Burns to look at our whole system of what we measure and why, to more accurately capture what the patient experience is, and that's what we'll be doing.
We are short for time this morning, so could I ask for answers to be brief as possible? Thanks. Donald.
And please, to the good morning, to both of you. Could I return to the issue of workforce planning? We use the phrase workforce plan, workforce planning a lot. Could I just ask a factual question? Is there a document or spreadsheet within NHS Scotland, which is a kind of master plan, which shows, for example, the current levels of staffing across all disciplines, the current levels of vacancies, predicted vacancies going forward, recommended staffing levels in 2017, 2018. Does it actually exist physically?
It does, in that each board has that level of information. We have that on a national basis. Also, ISD produce a lot of statistical information. So the information is there. I guess, though, the new bit of the regional and national workforce plan is bringing all that together, but not just in terms of what the picture is in the here and now, but projecting Precisely. On a regional and national basis of what is required in a more granular detail. And the fact that that is going to change the nature of the workforce and what it looks like is going to change probably more than we've ever seen. So that requires us to make sure, for example, in the primary care workforce, that it isn't just about producing more nurses and more doctors in the specialties that we have, and trying to land that as accurately as we can. And obviously the nursing and medical workforce numbers, the training places, all try to reflect what the needs of the service are going to be. This is different, though, because it's shifting the workforce into more primary and community care based services, which means the workforce and what it looks like needs to change. That's quite new, and that's why we need to take a national perspective
but
on that.
But what's not new, surely, is the fact that you need to project forward. You must have needed to project forward in 2010.
Yeah.
You must have needed to project forward in 2015. You must have some idea of what you will need in 2017, in 2018, in 2020, etc.
Well, of course, that's why we're able to project the number of nursing and midwifery training places, the number of medical training places. It's all based on what the analysis of the needs of the service are. But it's quite difficult to land that 100% accurately. But a lot of our workforce colleagues work very, very hard with boards to try and make sure, whether that's undergraduate places, whether that's training places, that we land as accurate as possible the needs of the service going forward. What I'm saying, though, is that we're in different territory going forward for the next 5, 10, 15 years, because the nature of services are going to change so dramatically, particularly that shift to primary care, and that requires us to look far more in a far more detailed way about how we create that new workforce in primary care.
Okay, Richard, then Colin.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, Mr. Gray. You've used the buzzwords, as I call them this morning: transformation programme, reconfiguring services, local services. Things move on, we have to change, we have to look at how we can do things better. Do local health boards actually do enough in explaining what they're doing and why they're reconfiguring services? Too often the Scottish Government gets thrown at it that it's concentrating services. When local boards make decisions that local politicians don't like, they then ask you to call it in. I think that's what I call concentrating services. Do you think there is a better way of informing the public why services are being reconfigured, moved, concentrated, improved?
I think some boards are better than others at different times with service change proposals over the years. You can see where some boards have gone out and consulted the public in a very good and meaningful way, and whether everybody always likes the changes proposed, have been in some cases more accepting of those changes because of being, there's been a proper consultation. In other, there are other examples where you know, that's maybe not been handled quite so well. However, the point here is that boards will always be looking at the needs of their local population. Sometimes service changes happen quickly because of patient safety concerns, or the inability to recruit key staff makes a service unsustainable. That has ever been so over the years. I guess what's new, though, is that we now have the National Clinical Strategy, which provides the framework and blueprint for the future, really, of what the services need to look like in terms of those services that are more specialised in nature, that will perhaps have a more regional delivery focus, through to what is reasonable to expect your local hospital to provide, which will still be the majority of services, and also what more can be done in primary care that has at the moment may well be done in secondary care but doesn't need to be done in secondary care. So that's quite new. We've never had a blueprint for clinical services that lays out in that way what the vision should be. Obviously, we need boards to translate that locally and to make sure that what they do and the changes they make are in line with that national policy.
What annoys me is I got along to some of the information meetings that the local board in my area has, and they tell us what they're doing. But when it comes out in the paper, it's entirely different. And the public perception is entirely different. So, you know, what can they do, really, honestly do to improve this? You know, have more meetings, more social media, more adverts?
I mean, all of those may be justified and relevant. I think communication is key. I think boards need to be able to set out not just why they're making the changes, but what a new service will look like. I think sometimes that's the missing bit of actually describing and showing and demonstrating, which is not always easy, but trying to demonstrate what a new service will look like. Because quite often when you go back and talk to the public and patients once a change has happened, they actually think the new service is better, but they might not have thought that when the change was being proposed. So, you know, change is difficult. It is, and it will always be so. I think however, it is required. If we're going to invest the £500 million of additional resources in primary care and shift that resource, people, you know, I don't know what people think shifting resources and shifting the balance of care means other than doing less in acute and more in primary care. That's what it means. And that means that things need to change and services need to change. Otherwise, someone perhaps around this table could tell me how else £500 million in primary care is going to be invested. That's how it's going to be done. But we need to make sure that the public are with us on that journey, that they can hear about how much more can be done at their local health centre instead of them having to travel miles potentially to their local hospital or to a hospital much further away. I think the public will get a better service out of that, but we need to explain that.
Thank you.
Colin, then Ivan.
Much convenient. Can I come back to the issue of efficiency savings? Because I think it does touch on the point that Richard Lyle made about taking the public with us when it comes to transformational change. We have to be honest with the public when it comes to what's actually happening with regards to savings. The key message in the Audit Scotland report is that funding hasn't kept pace with rising demand. That's a fact. Health boards are having to make, as the report says, unprecedented savings, £291 million in 2015-16, rising to £492 million in 2016-17. Can I ask Mr. Gray and the Cabinet Secretary, are you seriously saying to the public that every single one of those savings that health boards will make is entirely efficiency savings?
Well, I'll hand over to you in a second, Paul, just to say, though, that you will recognise that, as I said earlier in an answer, that all the parties put forward a perspective for funding into health. My party's commitment to the £500 million above inflation was the highest of any party. That went in front of the public, and the public made their choices, and the health service has now had a percentage uplift above inflation. Obviously, boards are varied, but every board has had an above inflation uplift. Efficiency savings have always been part of the changing the way services are delivered, and every penny of those efficiency savings are reinvested into the front line. But what we do expect boards to do is to make sure that they are making those efficiency savings in the right way in order to free up resources to the front line. But you're right about demand rising, and that's why Audit Scotland's conclusions are that reform is what is required. Audit Scotland themselves say that actually throwing more and more money at the NHS is not really the key answer. The key answer is reform and doing things differently, and we agree with that. And that's why, despite increasing levels of investment, that in itself is not enough. We have to change the way we do things, keeping people out of hospital, treating more people within primary and community services. I've not heard any other alternative plan to the one we've put forward, and my plea would be that people get behind that, Paul.
Thanks, Mr. Smith. There are some things that we do need to stop and want to stop. So this is not about simply trying to make everything better and faster. I'm sure the Chief Medical Officer would be happy to brief the committee on her approach to realistic medicine, which, if implemented effectively, will mean that certain procedures of limited value will be stopped. We won't do them anymore because they are of limited value. Now, that's a discussion that needs to be had with the public, and clinicians are much better placed to have that discussion than I am. But so this is not about us saying everything will simply continue as it is, but it will be a bit better and a bit faster. But there are efficiency savings that we have made, which, for example, in NHS Fife, they have an efficiency programme to have greater compliance with the agreed drug formulary, and that is going to produce a saving of £8 million by getting 80% compliance in NHS Fife. They have done work on the community respiratory team in Glasgow Health and Social Care to support patients with COPD. That's reduced inpatient admissions, reduced the length of stay when admitted, and led to more efficient use of medicines and devices at home. Now, I'm not going to give a great long list, convener, I'm conscious of time. So, yes, there are things that will stop, but they'll stop because they're not delivering value, or because we have better techniques, or because there are improved treatments or better drugs now on the market. Under no circumstances am I trying to suggest to the committee that everything will remain the same. As the Cabinet Secretary has said, it cannot remain the same and deliver what the people of Scotland need.
Well, convener, the question was, are all the savings efficiency savings? So are you telling the committee today that not a single one of the £492 million worth of savings that health boards will have to make in 2016-17 will adversely impact on patient care? Not a single penny of those savings, every one of them is efficiency or changes to do things better, that none of them are to do with balancing the books, none of them will impact adversely on patient care?
It's important the books are balanced. But it's important that patients get a good service, and what we expect boards to do and the changes they make is to make the services better, delivering them in a different way. But they can be delivered in a more efficient way. Paul Gray's just outlined a small number of examples of how that can happen. If we don't encourage boards and support boards to make those changes, then nothing will change. And we do require to make sure that every penny and every pound is spent in the most efficient way. That's, I would say, a prudent way to manage the finances of the health service.
I don't think anybody disagrees with that, Cabinet Secretary, but that wasn't the question. The reality is, if we're going to take the public with us when it comes to transformational change, we have to be honest with the public. And I don't think it's being honest if we say to them that not a single penny of the savings that health boards are making will adversely impact on their care. Staff see it every day, patients see it every day. Why don't we just be honest with the public and actually say, look, these are difficult decisions that will impact adversely because there isn't sufficient funding there. It isn't meeting the demand. Instead of simply dismissing funding as, well, it's only an efficient saving, it's only change. You cannot take the public with you unless you be honest and say, yes, there will be cuts made by health boards that will adversely impact on patient care.
But all those efficiency savings are reinvested in services that patients want and need. It's not efficiency savings are are there to help drive reform and change and then reinvest in the front line. It's about doing things better and differently. Some of those decisions inevitably will be difficult because change is difficult, as I was saying earlier on. But, you know, and of course we work with boards to make sure that what the efficiency savings that they have identified are ones that are going to make those improvements. So we're not just sitting back saying to boards, go and do whatever you want. Of course, that's a managed process and we require them to discuss with us the level of efficiency savings, what those efficiency savings are, and importantly, what they're going to deliver in terms of change.
Can I just follow up one question on the funding? You mentioned your manifesto commitments, Cabinet Secretary. Can you tell me where in the manifesto you committed to reducing local government budgets by £450 million? And do you think that's been a good thing when it comes to social care and preventative health, or a bad thing?
Well, I think what the public made their choices based on the manifesto perspective that each of the parties put forward. We put forward a prospectus to increase health funding by £500 million more than inflation. The public made their choices and made their decision. And, you know, I think at the end of the day, that's what elections and democracy is about. And, you know, we were very clear about what our priorities for spend were. We've also, of course, transferred £250 million into social care because we believe that it's important that we look at the whole system, and health and care are inextricably linked, and that's why the £250 million into social care is not just delivering extra capacity in social care, which can get people out of hospital and keep people out of hospital, but also delivering the living wage for 40,000 care workers, which is hopefully something that you would welcome.
I certainly do welcome it because I did propose it several years ago. But
I need to stop you there. Okay. We have run over because we started a wee bit late, and I've got three members of the committee who still want in. So, Ivan, then Claire.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. I just want to clarify and dig a wee bit deeper onto some of these the numbers on the budget and understand this a wee bit better, because there's people throwing stuff about cuts this and cuts that. Is it true to say that the budget in 2015-16 was £12.2 billion and in 16-17 it's £12.9 billion, which is an increase in cash terms of £700 million?
That's correct.
Yeah.
Yes.
And even taking into account inflation, the increase in real terms is 2.7%.
Correct.
Right, so there's more money going into the health service, there's twice as much money extra going into the health service as you need to cover the inflation cost rise. So that's the fact of what's going in. If you then look at the page on the Audit Scotland report, they talk about £490 million in savings. But obviously that's within the context of extra funds going in. So is it not then therefore true to identify that as being a redirection of resources within the health service? Because effectively you're taking money from one area and moving that £490 million along with the extra £700 million that's going on top of that into other areas of the health service. Would that be
correct?
A better characterisation?
That's correct. And without doing that, we wouldn't be able to resource the shift and the balance and the investment in primary care and the changes that need to be made. So, you know, you can't do that just with new money alone. You have to also shift the existing resources, which is partly what the efficiency savings.
Absolutely. So that's clear. Just to make that clear, because people look at that and think there's £492 million of cuts, in actual fact, it's a £700 million increase in cash terms. And clearly that comes down to what you deliver for that. But it's also true to say there's been an increase in demand. There's more GP visits. There's more inpatient episodes, more outpatient demand, plus the cost of drugs are going up. So in terms of what's been delivered from that money, which is the real measure of efficiency, it'd be true to say we're getting more bang for our buck, if you like, in terms of the output from the health service.
There are far more people being treated in the health service than ever before. Yeah. Outpatient demands, inpatient demand, GP demands, yes, absolutely, which is the Audit Scotland point, that demand is growing, and we have to manage that demand and make sure that we use the collective resources of all of the skills of the NHS to perhaps get people to the right place. That's the programme of reform and transformation that's underway. So yes, and that's the caveat, although there are additional resources in the NHS, including a redirection of existing resources, demand is growing.
Okay. Just one final point then. I mean, clearly there's a direction, the National Clinical Strategy, integration, etc. And health boards are coming forward with proposals that the state are aligned with that. But clearly each of those proposals would need to be examined to understand whether it actually aligned with that strategy or whether the health board was just putting it in the context of that and it didn't actually align with that strategy.
Correct.
And clearly that it doesn't, everything the health board comes forward with doesn't necessarily comply with that strategy just because the health board describes it in that way. And I suppose really what I want to ask, but if you look through the Audit Scotland report at the end of that, it talks about an example in New Zealand where they've actually made that shift in Canterbury from towards more integration and towards community spend. I just wonder if we'd looked at that in a bit of detail and if you'd any understanding of how they actually did that and what it delivered in real terms. Because at the moment it's very much about, we've got an aspiration, we think it's going to save us money, in theory it should, but as the report says, we don't actually have hard and fast numbers. Does that New Zealand experience give us any confidence of how much can be delivered by going down that road?
I mean, we have looked at international experience and you can draw some information from that, but you know, every health service has got its kind of uniqueness, so the solution has to be a Scottish solution. Whereas, you know, I'm sure there are lessons to be learned from elsewhere, but I think the plan, the strategies that we have are very much kind of born out of the needs of the Scottish population and the type of systems that we have here.
Okay, thanks.
Finally, Miles.
Secretary. Good morning, Mr. Gray. One of the aspects of Audit Scotland's report, which hasn't been sort of touched on within the Parliament, I think, is around the buildings estate, which we have, and the fact that there are now repairs needed to almost a third of all NHS buildings, with a 50% maintenance backlog, with boards now classifying these as high risk and significant. What programme are you aware of this being addressed? And are we actually seeing a situation where we're building up an NHS buildings crisis in the future? And on the other point, just to touch upon Ivan McKee's question to you, what do you actually think health inflation sits at?
So on the estates, I mean, there was a recent report that showed from memory, and again, I can do right with the details to the committee, that actually there had been an improvement in the amount of work being done on the most urgent parts of the estate. I think it's also important to note that there's been a massive and continuing massive capital investment in renewing the estate. If you look at the not just the hospital build programme, but also the investments in new health and care centres and primary care. So there is a lot of capital investment in renewing the estate and making it fit for the future, but certainly happy to write to you with more details on that. In terms of health service inflation, Steve?
Yeah, so traditional pay and prices and inflation varies from 1% on pay to 10% on drugs. Taken as an average across all the areas of expenditure, pay and prices inflation is between 2 and 3%, probably closer to 3 than 2. And we also estimate that changes in demographics amount to about 1% per annum in costs. So in other words, if the demographic trends continue, that will cost us another 1% a year.
Circa 3%.
3%.
To come back on both those points, I think what's concerning for me in terms of the estate is the report outlined the fact that both NHS Lothian and Tayside, who are both in the most difficult financial positions, have fallen back in their estate under that report, and the number of buildings at high risk and significant have increased. So I think that's something we really have to be aware of, and decision making being taken by these boards. The health committee's had a number of people giving evidence who have said that they see health inflation at 6%. I think that's where a lot of discrepancy seems to be between budgeting within the health service, if you're working towards between 1 and 3% from what you just said.
We can't really account for what others say in terms of their on inflation. What we're seeing is this: these are the figures from the work that's been done around health, the health department, and The GDP deflator is 1.8%, which is a proxy for general inflation. Inflation in health is around 3%, taking into account of the other aspects that Paul Gray talked about, and that's the basis of the calculations that we make.
Just to be clear, the Audit Scotland report's got it in here as 3.1%. Mm-hmm. That's what Audit Scotland think it is.
Given we accept the Audit Scotland report, I think that's probably a good place to agree on.
And that there is some correspondence with health boards, because certainly the health board, my own health board, tells me that it's sitting at 6%. So clearly, if the, you know, if NHS centrally are working to a different figure that boards are working to, we have a problem, and it may be that some correspondence in that might be helpful. Sorry, I'm going to have to finish us there. Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. We will suspend very briefly, and we will try and catch up on time in the next session. Okay. The second item on our agenda is the final evidence session on recruitment and retention in the health service. Could I welcome to the committee Shona Robertson, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport, Shirley Rogers, Director of Health, Workforce and Strategic Change, and Fiona McQueen, Chief Nursing Officer, All Scottish Government. Could I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement?
Thanks, Convener. Thanks for the invitation to speak again to the committee this morning. We're all aware that demand for health and social care services is changing, as is the way those services are delivered. In response, the Scottish Government has a programme of transformational change to take us towards the 2020 vision and beyond. But we can't deliver that without a sustainable workforce. Our approach to delivering that workforce is described in Everyone Matters, the 2020 vision. In short, we need to ensure that the right people are available to deliver the right care in the right place at the right time. Key to our ability to recruit and retain our staff is our attractiveness and inclusiveness as an employer. Through our work on staff governance standard, NHS Scotland has made significant progress in recent years. We've worked closely with our staff side partners and health board colleagues to ensure that we've developed high quality supportive policies and terms and conditions for our staff that also recognise the highest standards of equality and diversity and help us deliver on our vision for NHS Scotland to be an exemplar employer. I was delighted to see the good work of NHS Scotland being recognised in practice, with the Golden Jubilee National Hospital being recently voted as Employer of the Year at the 2016 Awards. Under this government, staff numbers have increased by over 11,000. This includes 5%, over 5% more qualified nurses and midwives and over 25% more doctors. We now have a record number of consultants, up by 43% during the term of this government. But we're not complacent. We recognise that challenges remain and continue, that we need to improve the long-term sustainability of our workforce, particularly in remote and rural settings. We are growing our medical workforce, in addition to increasing specialty training places by 124 in the last 3 years. We have increased undergraduate medical school places by 50 from this year, with these places focusing on widening access criteria. And the ScotGem Graduate Medical School will add a further 40 places from 2018 and will have a focus on general practice and rurality. We signalled our intention that the ScotGem programme will have an element of bonding, and by that I mean an arrangement whereby in return for reimbursement of the costs of their education, an individual commits to a period of employment in the NHS. I'm aware of the evidence given to the committee last week and realise that there is a range of views on such arrangements. We're in the process of developing our policy on bonding, and I welcome this opportunity to discuss it further with the committee and the wider stakeholder community. We're committed to producing a national and regional workforce plan by the spring of next year. The plan will seek to address capacity issues consistently in the right places and at the right levels within our workforce to help deliver the transformation agenda envisaged in our national clinical strategy. We recognise the need to strengthen workforce planning to ensure the workforce is able to deploy and manage its huge range of knowledge and skills to best effect, not just in the right numbers, but in the places they need to be at the right times. I recognise that these initiatives will not produce instant results. We're therefore also looking at actions that will help address the challenges we face now. A number of key actions are underway to reduce the use of costly agency staff, including the use of a staff bank system and a long-standing framework contract. We accept that we need to do more and have launched with National Services Scotland a nationally coordinated programme to ensure the effective management of all temporary staffing and help boards reduce their reliance on these. We're also well aware that some parts of the country, including rural areas, have particular challenges in relation to recruitment. We invested £2 million in GP recruitment and retention, which includes the Scottish Rural Collaborative and support for deep end practices. And we're also working with universities to increase meaningful exposure to remote and rural placements at undergraduate level. And additionally, we're encouraging those who are trained or worked in NHS Scotland to return and work here in the health service. And finally, in relation to the issue of Brexit, I have to highlight that in the context of a highly competitive international recruitment and retention market, there is a real risk that we'll lose many valued individuals if we can't offer reassurances on free movement and future career opportunities. I'm certainly committed to building a sustainable health and social care workforce for the future and welcome this opportunity to discuss these issues further.
Thank you. We are extremely short of time, so if people could be brief with questions and answers. Alex.
Last week, Cabinet Secretary, we heard evidence from both the midwifery profession and the nursing profession, both of whom revealed that 5 or 6 years ago, the Scottish Government cut back training places in the midwifery profession. That equated to about more than a half of training places lost. But yet now they talk about a crisis of recruitment based on around retirement. Given that workforce planning in the NHS at the moment is only 5 years, will the workforce plan that you talk about next year take account of the Audit Scotland report that points out rightly we need to be staring much further into the future, recognising it takes up to 7-10 years to train some primary care professionals? And will that be reflected in the plan you bring forward?
Well, of course, over the last 3 years, if we want to say a bit more about this, but we've increased nursing and midwifery numbers, of course, not just in terms of those positions that we've looked at, also increasing those in advanced training, so increasing the number of advanced nurse practitioner posts by 500, I think it was. So, you know, we are very aware that that workforce is critically important, not just in our hospital sector, but in our primary care sector as well. And we have been working very closely with NES to develop opportunities, particularly for that advanced nurse practice career route, because we know that whether that's in emergency medicine, whether it's in primary care, the roles of those advanced nurses is going to be critical in delivering those new models.
Absolutely, and I think the RCM when they spoke last week, recognised that at the time of the cuts of or the reduction in the undergraduate numbers, there were hundreds of unemployed midwives and nurses. So we had 800 nurses on return to practice. We had nurses and midwives qualifying and not able to get jobs. So we have a planning process that does look at retirement rates, and clearly people have now choice of retiring from 55 onwards, and therefore that is a challenge, because clearly overproduction isn't helpful either, because that then stops good people coming into the profession. Over the last 3 years, we have increased the numbers, and the numbers of midwives in training has been increasing over the last 3 years.
Can I ask who signs off the annual intake?
It's a process. Ultimately, the Cabinet Secretary agrees.
That's fine.
It's a process of negotiation of the profession.
And the trade unions are involved. Care home sector is now involved.
Okay, Claire.
Firstly, I'd just like to get my head around some of the figures around vacancy rates. The ISD published figure for June said that the nursing and midwifery vacancy rate was 4.2%, and for other AHPs 4.4. What would you see as a usual percentage of vacancies? Because we're not going to have every post filled all of the time.
Well, I guess one of the challenges here is the more posts you create, the higher the vacancy rate, particularly in some areas where it's harder to recruit. And boards will have varying vacancy rates. That's obviously a kind of national figure, but there will be variations across the board.
It takes time. So 4%, I think if you look at industry norms, then that is moderate. I think it depends which post you have. If you're talking about a staff nurse who's delivering care all of the time, then you need to replace that person right away. Similarly with our support workers, and that's easier to have a recruitment line and along with workforce colleagues, the nurse and mid and workforce directors and boards are looking at how you can efficiently fill posts, because again, someone might give 4 weeks notice, but actually the recruitment process takes longer than that. So a number of boards are anticipating, looking at their turnover and bringing people in so that there is almost no vacancy for that post being left. The more specialist posts do take time to recruit, and even if there is no difficulty in recruiting, by the time someone gives you 1 month's notice and then you pull people in, it is going to be longer, that there will be a period of vacancy. So I think it depends on in which area you're in, how long people are leaving their posts for, then it does vary. But 4% doesn't seem unreasonable. I think the over 3 months ones are perhaps indicators of where it's beginning to get trickier to recruit into, but Shirley might want to.
I think it's very difficult to take a global answer to that. There are specialties that are harder to recruit for. I wonder whether or not the committee might find it helpful to understand a little bit more about the nature of the workforce plan that currently takes place. I recognise the time, Chairman, but if I could briefly say a few words in that space. Mr Cameron, I think you were asking earlier on about the prospective nature of workforce planning. Over the past couple of years, we've put in place arrangements now that allow us to see our existing trained workforce and the supply through specialty doctors of those things that are coming through the training process, so that we can see both the consultant workforce as we have it and all of those people emerging from medical school and track them through training. And that's the case across all of the 56 major specialties in the health service. It allows us also to be able to make intelligent decisions based on projections around retirement age, for example. And this committee has heard evidence before about the impact on UK pension changes and so on. That allows us to see what happens if that consultant workforce decides to retire a bit earlier or stays on a bit longer or whatever it is. So the approach over the last couple of years is using something called the six-step workforce planning methodology. It's an industry standard. It's an international industry standard. It doesn't pertain just to the health service. It's used by a number of big employers across the globe that looks at short, medium and long-term recruitment needs, how to nuance those depending on the circumstances and individual choices that people make. That methodology has been shared across the health service, so is now a requirement for how workforce planning is done in every board in Scotland. That's a relatively recent development. Perhaps more importantly, in the space of health and social care integration, we're busy sharing that with colleagues in local authorities to make sure that they're using a similar methodology. And indeed, we've made an invitation to any other employer operating in that space to use the similar methodology. That should allow us to be able to address as best we can those issues that are now, but more importantly, to deal with the medium and longer term. I just thought it might be helpful to give that context to the committee in terms of the workforce planning methodology.
Thank you, Convener. I want to come back on something that's a bit more specific around about nurse retention, if you like. And I need to declare an interest here because I'm a registrant with the NMC and I'm currently going through the revalidation process. And it's really round about registration and revalidation. I'm wondering if any work has been done on how many nurses and midwives are actually leaving the profession due to the revalidation process, which is quite a complex process. And also around about nurses who and midwives who fall off the register due to late payment of the registration fees and the excessive amount of time that it takes the NMC to get people back onto the register, up to 3 months at a time, which leaves nurses and midwives without a source of income, often women, often part-time, often sole parents. So I'd be really keen to hear the comments of what Scottish Government are doing in terms of supporting that part of the workforce.
I'm happy to do that and equally happy to give you some granular information on a month-by-month basis about the revalidation and people either lapsing or not. What we have found is that there is little difference from the number of people who are remaining on the register, and particularly in September was going to be our crunch month as we had a lot of registrants qualifying in September and then the revalidation would be 3 yearly from that. So we found both in the care home sector and also across the NHS in Scotland that there has been little difference since revalidation has come in. We've watched that very closely. So we invested money over the last 2 years to support each board. So we gave them resource to support them, to support practitioners with revalidation. And we work closely with the NMC to get the statistics and the data on that. The matter of paying, so other committee members may not know that every 3 years we now have a system of submitting for revalidation, but we have to pay an annual fee. And until quite recently, the annual fee, if you missed it by a few days, then it didn't matter. Now the NMC says it takes between 2 and 8 weeks. We are continuing to encourage the NMC to be as quick as they can in their processes, fully recognising the financial challenge that registrants have, but also the issue about care delivery. They're not able to deliver care as a registered nurse. So we're continuing to work closely with the NMC on that, and we're looking at ways that we can flag within boards to make sure that nurses are reminded, because the NMC does remind people quite regularly on what needs to be done. But in terms of their fees, then the nurses know that they have an annual fee to pay. And any time we do hear of anyone being having that struggle, then we will direct them to someone within their board who can help them to make sure that they're paying. The NMC also have introduced a way to spread fees in terms of direct debit, so instalments rather than the £120 a year as well. So the NMC is doing its best to support registrants to maintain the registration.
Richard.
Thank you, Convener. It takes an average, I believe, 5 to 7 years to train a doctor. I was surprised when I last met the BMA that a doctor, once trained, can just go away, can go anywhere in the world. You said earlier, Cabinet Secretary, about bonding, which is a new word to me. Why don't we actually tie them down to a contract that they've got? If you've been trained in Scotland, you live in Scotland, you work in Scotland, should you not pay back to Scotland before you leave? I hate using that word.
So I'll say a little bit more about this in a moment, but you know, we want people to remain here and train and work here, and a lot of evidence is that actually if they've had a good training experience and good experiences in their placements, that actually is a big encourager for doctors to want to stay here in Scotland. But it is an international market, and we have looked at how can we encourage, whether that's with financial incentives or other ways of keeping people here in the NHS. The graduate programme lends itself well to bonding, because obviously it's a second degree and therefore the fees are not automatically paid. So there's an opportunity there for to offer any payment of fees through the graduate programme with a commitment to the NHS here in Scotland. I think that would be more challenging to do in the undergraduate programme. And, you know, it's not that it's not been explored. And, of course, we'll keep an open mind of what more we could do. But, you know, that would be more challenging, the undergraduate programme, to do that. Also, just, I know you'll be interested in this, particularly around the widening access. The 50 new places from this year, which were agreed with the medical schools, we felt it was very important that those studying medicine were drawn from a wider socio-economic base, and that's why we linked those 50 additional places to the widened access criteria. Again, we think that the more we do of that and drawing people from a wider variety of backgrounds, the more chance we'll have of them staying here working in the NHS in Scotland. Charlie.
Thank you. Scotland has five of the most highly regarded medical schools in the world. It draws and attracts candidates from all over the world. I think it's one of the things that Scotland should be very proud of. It has a long history of medical academia and a long history of medical research, which is very attractive in an international marketplace. And we operate in an international marketplace for medics. And it's right that we do. We are extremely innovative, but we're not the only innovative place. However, there is evidence that suggests quite strongly that those Scots domicile students who attend Scottish medical schools are more likely to either immediately practice in Scotland or come back to practice in Scotland. So they may go somewhere else to gain some experience and then return to Scotland at a later date. What we're trying to do is to create a space where NHS Scotland is internationally recognised as an attractive place to practice medicine. And there is an enormous amount of work been done to improve working lives across the NHS, but specifically around junior doctors, for example. And that recognition is starting to accrue. So we, as the CABSEC has said, have focused a particular endeavour around the introduction of a first for Scotland, the first time we'll have a graduate medical school in Scotland. We've done that because we recognise that people who are doing second degrees, generally speaking, are a little bit older, a little bit more settled in the environment space they want to live, and have perhaps made some decisions already domestically that would site them more readily in Scotland. They've perhaps made some life choices already. It seems, therefore, that if we can support those individuals to make those choices, then the options for us to be able to have some payback for that investment are in front of us. As the Cabinet Secretary indicated, we're in the foothills of that consideration at the moment. So whilst there are a number of schemes, and committee members may be aware that this is a model that has been used in the military for a number of years, it is used in some parts of the world. So there are a number of models, but we're making sure that what we've got is a balance of trying to make sure that we've got people who really want to work in Scotland to make their medical careers here and make their lives here. And I believe that that's something that we'll be able to do.
How much is the funding or bonding on offer?
Well, we haven't reached that stage yet, but, you know, I guess we'd be looking at perhaps a situation of, you know, if a year's fees were paid, you would expect a year commitment to the NHS would be an obvious way of doing it. But we need to work through the detail of that before the programme starts.
So if you commit to stay 5 years, we'll pay your 5 years fees?
Well, that's an option.
Thank you.
Through the detail.
Okay, Marie.
Thanks, Convener. As a representative for the Highlands and Islands, I'm keen to ask about rural recruitment. I'm interested to know if this widening access scheme, we heard time and time again that people from the Highlands and Islands are quite keen to get back, and I know that from my own personal experience. Is this widening access scheme going to cover people growing up in rural areas who might face challenges in getting the right qualifications to enter medical school because of the limited options available at the high schools in rural areas in the Highlands and Islands?
We have three further members who wish to get in, and we're really short of time, so brief, please.
Well, the Scotch system is going to partner with Highland in terms of rural placements and rural opportunities. Plus, there's obviously existing programmes like through the Rural Collaborative to try and encourage and retain staff working within rural areas. But I think the graduate scheme has the ability to give people a very positive experience of working in a rural area. And of course, we'll also have a bias towards general practice as well.
I meant specifically in terms of getting access to medical school.
It's one of a number of things that we're hoping will do that. So we're currently working with schools to look at the triangulation of qualification medical school applicant and the child's desire to study. Mm-hmm. So we're working with education colleagues to try and make sure that the curriculum that is necessary is available. And I think that's probably the biggest win if we can achieve that. There is no doubt that the postgraduate entry requirements lend themselves better to those students who've not been able, for example, to study higher chemistry in rural parts of Scotland. The other thing which Cabinet Secretary mentioned briefly in her opening remarks was the rural bursaries, which we have seen as being terribly advantageous in looking to recruit in rural parts of Scotland. So it's a totality of things as opposed to just a thing, but that totality ought to achieve that objective. Because again, there is very strong evidence that people from those communities who can practice in those communities stay in those communities.
Absolutely. To just broaden the question beyond medical staff as well, we heard from all of the professions, midwives and nurses and allied health professionals particularly, that they're struggling to offer opportunities to get work experience in rural areas, and that there might be additional costs for people who want to go and work in rural areas during their training period, either as undergraduates or postgraduate students. Are the government going to do anything to tackle that? And I have to say, I do welcome the strategies that you've put in place to tackle the issues already.
I mean, we already provide 300 pre-registration nursing places through the University of Stirling and the University of the Highlands and Islands, and a further 60 nursing students from seven boards covering remote and rural areas through the Open University. And I think that does provide a very good option for those who are from the Highlands and Islands. The Western Isles have a particularly good programme, and again, it's about growing your workforce from school right the way through to qualification.
We are also reviewing the financial support we give to other undergraduates, so HP undergraduates. Nurses already get travel and accommodation when they're on placements, and again, we're looking at more rural placements for our undergraduates.
Thank you.
Ivan?
Yeah, but just very quickly to comment on the workforce planning tool, and I'm glad to hear the comment Shelley Roger made just there, because in previous sessions we've had people telling us workforce planning was difficult to the point of being too difficult, and we couldn't expect them to actually deliver anything coherent on that. So I'm glad to hear that you're on top of that. I mean, having done it in the past, my experience is 90% science, and it's about getting the right variables, understanding how those are trending, making adjustments based on that. But more importantly, you'll get it wrong, but knowing what to go back and look at when you do get it wrong to understand whether the decisions you made were coherent based on the data. The only question is it possible to have a wee look at the planning tool? I'd be interested. I don't know if other members would be interested as well, just to see what it's capable of doing.
Happy to share the six-step methodology.
Brilliant.
With the committee.
Thanks very much.
Alison.
Thank you, Convener. I'd just like to ask what action has been taken to ensure that those working in the professions are having access to a suitable level of ongoing professional development, because I think it was Jill Vickerman again who said that is an issue
and it's one that's perhaps not making medicine as attractive as it might be in Scotland. And also very quickly, Convener, if I may, to ask what specific action is being undertaken to recruit in our deep end practices. Thank you.
I think partly it's about making sure that people can have the time and backfilling to be able to take on professional development opportunities. I think that's, we need to ensure that there's an equality of access to those opportunities. I think there are issues, and certainly in some areas where that's more difficult, but without a doubt CPD is hugely important for career development and, you know, for opportunities. Do you want to...
Yeah, if I can pick that up and also identify myself as the individual that's leading the work to develop the Transformational Strategic Change Plan, which we've mentioned a number of times already at this meeting this morning. In amongst that, we recognise that education and reskilling, upskilling, maintaining skills is a fundamental part of transformation. So the opportunities to be able to do that, some of the testing that's been dealt with already in terms of new models of care, are absolutely critical to that piece of work, and we're configuring to do that in a whole range of different ways. So if I give an example that goes a little bit beyond the remit of doctors and nurses, because we always tend to talk about doctors and nurses, one of the quiet successes of the last couple of years has been the development of the educational framework for healthcare support workers, which extends way beyond health into all of the sort of social care provision and gives a career framework educationally based that allows people to join at a relatively modest level of skill and use that framework to develop their skills and, of course, enhance their careers as they go. And that's the approach and methodology that we're taking throughout. In respect to the deep end practice, we were talking, I think the Cabinet Secretary mentioned deep end practice earlier on. If not, I can say that the work that we've been doing to explore the benefits of a rural bursary, we are now starting to give consideration to whether a bursary around deep end practice would also be effective.
It's also, you might be aware that we've agreed with the BMA a full review of all aspects of GP pay and expenses. It's going to take place next year to inform options from 2018, which of course is the Scottish allocation formula is part of those discussions. And I think I've said before that, you know, we need to get that right. Our support for deep end practices is important, but we need to look beyond that in terms of how we ensure that those GPs working in more deprived areas get the support they require. And of course we've also got the other supports through the things like the 250 link workers to support practices in deprived areas, but it is a very much a focus of our discussions as we take forward the new contract. Thank you.
Miles.
Thank you, Convener. Between 2006 and 2013 the number of student nurse placements was cut by a quarter. Does the panel now believe that was the wrong decision? And with regards to universities, the number of places for domiciled Scots students at Scottish universities is capped. And what impact do you think this is having, especially given that we're now seeing a historical low of just 52% of Scottish domicile students going to our medical schools?
Well, Fiona can come in on the nursing numbers, although I think she answered that in some detail earlier on about the oversupply at one point and needing to adjust the workforce requirements, and you know that does change over time, and it's quite difficult to land that 100% accurately. But of course, the last 3 years we have seen an increase in the number of undergraduate places, and that will filter through into the workforce. But it's also important to have an advanced nurse training as well as undergraduate training. In terms of the places, I mean, it might be of interest to the committee to look at the numbers. If you look at the overall numbers of medical students in Scotland, and as Charlie Rogers said, we have 5 medical schools, which is actually is very high for a population of 5.3 million. And if you look at the makeup of those numbers, if you look at the overall total number of medical students across the UK, it's just over 40,000. Now, our population share of that, if you were taking a population share, would be just short of 3,500. However, we have over 1,400 more students than that. So in essence, we are providing and producing far more medical graduates than our population share would determine. So therefore, you have to see the percentage of Scots domicile students within that context that actually are medical schools. If we're to sustain five medical schools, which we want to do, they have to be able to draw their medical undergraduates from a wider source, whether that's the rest of the UK or indeed internationally, because they, you know, we do have, as I say, we produce far more medical graduates than our population share or any other part of the UK per head of population, which is a good thing. And our five medical schools are internationally recognised. But in order to sustain them as we want them to do, they do have to draw from a wider pool than just Scotland.
And do you think that's a financing issue then, regarding the fact that international students can be charged up to £30,000 to study at Scottish universities, whereas obviously Scottish domicile wouldn't be?
Well, I think universities, and we discuss this with them, and the funding council are obviously involved in this, but you know, Scottish or medical schools have always drawn from a wide variety of backgrounds and places. I suppose that's part of the kind of richness of those medical schools. Clearly, there are a number of international students who study medicine in Scotland. There are also a large number from the rest of the UK. We want them to stay working here in Scotland, and we try to encourage them to do so through the mechanisms that Shirley outlined earlier on. Do you want to add in?
No, I think that covers it. I mean, the reality of it is that universities survive by having a mixture of students from their domicile mm-hmm. countries, from international backgrounds, and from the rest of the UK. We have a very close relationship with the Board for Academic Medicine, which represents the medical schools in Scotland. I meet with them very regularly. Coming back to the question from Ms. Todd earlier on, they're very keen to work on a collaborative basis now to provide placement opportunities, for example, in remote and rural locations or deep end practices. Those relationships are very good. I think my endeavour as the workforce director for the NHS in Scotland is to have a sustainable world-class workforce.
Within that, of course, we do want more Scots-based students, which is why we're widening the number of undergraduate medical places even further with the additional 50. That'll be 250 places over a five-year period, plus the graduate medical school. So it's not that we don't recognise the need to expand the number of Scots-based students. But, you know, important
within... That figure is capped. That's my question, which hasn't really been answered. That figure is capped of Scottish domicile students getting to go to these universities. Now, what impact is that actually having?
I was going to come back to that question because I don't recognise the point that you're making in respect of the cap. The
64% of Scots were going to medical schools when this Parliament was reconvened. It's now down to 52% because of the cap.
If you look at the overall numbers, we produce a huge number of medical graduates beyond what our population share would. I mean, if we only produced the number of medical graduates that, you know, as a percentage of the 40,000...
Well, Ms. Rogers has said that it's important that domicile people are able to study in their country. Mm-hmm. In Scotland, we're reducing that. And in terms of tackling the shortage we're seeing, if we have more Scottish domicile studying, that's going to help, surely. Well, and that's where the cap is not helping.
And we've just increased the number of places by 50, and we've linked those to widening access. So those will be people from poorer backgrounds getting into medicine that wouldn't previously have gone into medicine. That's 250 more medical places over the course of 5 years. Plus the graduate school, I think, will draw mainly from Scots domicile students because of the nature of them being a bit older and more settled, as Shirley Rogers said earlier. So we are expanding the number of Scots domicile students, but you know, it is within a context of a large pool of medical places here in Scotland that is sustained partly by drawing people from elsewhere.
Okay, I'm not getting very far with this.
Thank you very much. Can we now suspend briefly for a change of panel?
The third item on our agenda is the first evidence session in our mental health inquiry. The session will look at child and adolescent mental health. Can I welcome to the committee Rachel Stewart, Senior Public Affairs Officer, Scottish Association for Mental Health, Sophie Pilgrim, Director, Kindred Advocacy, and a representative of the Children's Services Coalition, and Michael Gowan, Member of the Scottish Youth Parliament. Could I ask any of my colleagues if they wish to begin? Oh, sorry, before I begin, could one or all of you, probably one would be better given the time restriction, to explain the kind of tiered intervention in relation to child and adolescent mental health?
I can do that, if that would be helpful. CAMHS is set up in four tiers. Tier one is the least severe, tier four is the most severe. Tier one is the identification level, where the first instance where a child would seek help from universal services, whether that's teachers, thank you, whether that's GPs or others who would be working in universal services. It's the first port of call. Tier two is community-based CAMHS specialist services, where you would be working with primary mental health workers. Tier three is a bit more specialist, and that's where the actual access target starts to be applied, where children and young people should be seen within 18 weeks of referral to this CAMHS support. But it's for more severe, complex, persistent support. Tier four is specialist inpatient CAMHS, where young people need to be treated in hospital for a period of time.
See, my very limited experience in this when teaching was that there was quite significant pressure being put on support for learning staff and the like, not to include children in, for example, individual education plans, make referrals, all of that kind of thing, because of basically resource pressure. Is that your experience? Or is that, are you finding anecdotal evidence of that?
We've been finding anecdotal evidence of a bit of a mixed picture across Scotland, to be honest. There are some places which have quite good links between education and with CAMHS within the health service. There are other places where young people that we've surveyed and spoken to say that their guidance teacher didn't know about CAMHS and so on, and that line of communication and awareness link doesn't seem to be as good as it could be. In terms of whether universal services are being told not to refer because of pressures, I think we would need actually a bit more of an evaluation about what is happening across the board, and that's why SAMH has been calling for a wider review of the whole CAMHS service and the wider, the four-tier system. The information that we have is about the access point at tier three and onwards, but before that we don't know how many young people are seeking help and either being turned away or being told that they might grow out of it and they should just rest easy, you know, that it'll pass, you know. So I think that's why one of the reasons we've been calling for a wider review is to have a bit of an exploration, as we are on the cusp of a new 10-year mental health strategy, a new 10-year child and adolescent health strategy as well, that having a wider focus about the access points, how well professionals are equipped to deal with people asking for help, should be explored.
Anyway, within the system, has there been statistical analysis of how many young people are at each of these tiers? Over a period of time, are the numbers going down, up, or are they fairly consistent?
The numbers of young people who are being referred to tier three services has been going up. There's also been a rise in the number of young people who have not, having been referred to tier three CAMHS services, they've not been deemed unwell enough to require that level of support. But there has been the statistical analysis of the young people seeking support at universal level at tier one or at tier two. That's not measured in the same way because there's not a target attached to access points within those earlier stages of CAMHS support.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you. Alex?
Good morning to the panel. I think it's well known right around this table, both from the parliamentarians and stakeholders at the committee today, the real difficulty we have in terms of delay in the CAMS setup is not to in any way belittle the work of CAMS workers. That is measured out in a number of cases. For example, the fact that we don't have any tier four beds north of Dundee. Those that are available aren't always actually available because there aren't staff to man them. That in some cases, some parts of the country, children will have to wait up to 2 years, a considerable part of their young lives, for an initial appointment. In my own constituency, I had a situation where a child was struggling at school. Education psych referred her to CAMS on the belief that she might have undiagnosed autistic spectrum disorder. She was seen comparatively quickly within a couple of months and for an initial triage, and they said the family received the devastating news, yes, your daughter is on the autistic spectrum. And then she had to wait another year before formal diagnosis. And in that time, she missed out on any kind of state support that would have been afforded to her with a diagnosis. Can the panel reflect on that situation, what they think needs to change? Is it money? Is it investment? Is it a change in policy direction? Is it all of those things?
I'm director of an organisation. We support about 1,000 families every year, and a very high proportion have neurodevelopmental disorders and mainly autistic spectrum disorders. So in the situation that you're talking about, I think we experience that schools often don't recognise quite clear signs of autistic spectrum disorder early on, and it's actually when things start to go wrong that children get picked up. And then, as you say, that the problem then is that it can be a very, very long lead time until there is an actual formal diagnosis. And if you looking after a child with autism is just completely different from looking after a child without autism. I mean, I think they need, I mean, obviously there's a huge range in terms of autistic spectrum disorder, but there's certain things that people with autism have in common, and one of them is a need for structure and probably a need for a less stimulating environment. So until you get that diagnosis, you can't put in place that support. So in working with children with a very high level of additional support need, I think one of the issues that we see is that, as you mentioned at the beginning of your statement, there's a lack of the very high level tier four services. So in Scotland, we have no inpatient services for children with learning disability. We have no specialist inpatient services for children with autism, and we have no forensic inpatient services. And there's a report produced by Scottish Government and the Mental Welfare Commission, which is about to come out, recommending the provision of a central belt inpatient care for those children. And I think at the minute what's happening is, in fact, the impact of those children who have extreme needs means that the other services are actually distorted, because they're so much in need in the community. They're in really high level of distress. And what happens is the community services are drawn into those emergencies. Their time is taken up. Anyone who knows those CAMS psychiatrists, if you're in regular contact with them, you see the times they're not able to get on with their regular duties because it's taken up with this emergency care of children who need acute short periods in hospital. So I think that's a very big factor, is that we need that top level of support for children so that we can free up CAMS time to be diagnosing quicker.
Miles.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. And can I start maybe by congratulating the Scottish Youth Parliament for the work they've done on the survey and report? I think it's been really helpful in looking at what is a huge problem for our country. And one of the things which really interests me is actually early intervention and prevention. And we're getting a lot of mixed messages really about what's needed and how we improve that and how the Scottish Government's new strategy should be shaped around that. So I was just wondering from the panel, what do you think would make the most difference as an intervention or as additional information for young people and how that should be rolled out.
If I may, thanks for the plug. So one of the key things that have been identified, and this kind of links into the convener's point earlier, is about how in schools resources are stretched too thin. So we end up with teachers, quotes from our research, teachers are stretched too thin and there aren't enough resources. Another 25 students in one class is way too many for a class to be able to give one-to-one support. It should be like 10 or 15. So there's a point about how many young people we're expecting frontline practitioners to be able to manage and to be able to detect those issues. The other point is perhaps on training, how many teachers can afford to go through CPD, for example, in more rural areas where they have perhaps staff retention issues, they can't necessarily afford to have staff leaving as often for that continued professional development. And another point that has been raised is how comfortable are young people talking with those frontline practitioners. So in our research, only 24% of young people said that they would be comfortable talking to a teacher. So if you have only one in four in a classroom saying, I'm willing to talk to the person that I'm seeing every day, it creates a barrier for trying to get potentially quite young, quite vulnerable and perhaps underconfident young people to open up about any problems they're having and catching that earlier. So perhaps looking at how do we build those bridges between young people and with practitioners.
Can I follow up? I would absolutely endorse everything Michael's been saying. We know that there have been pilot projects in schools where mental health and wellbeing has been promoted. CME in schools are running pilots, which is having an impact on the whole school. In terms of young people feeling much more able to ask for help, teachers having been through some Scottish Mental Health First Aid, having been able to respond much more appropriately. And I think teachers often feel very stressed under their work as well. It's got a very high rate of sickness absence as well, so it might actually be helping them as a protective factor. I know of other pilots in the likes of People's High School and so on, which have done work in linking up with community third sector organisations such as Samaritans and Penumbra, where they have raised awareness within the schools, and that's made it much easier to signpost young people to support. I think health and wellbeing is one of the three crucial elements within the curriculum for excellence, and children and young people have been telling us that the only thing that they ever hear about from a mental health perspective is about exam stress and how to deal with that rather than being less stressed in general. I think that if health and wellbeing was included in the inspection of schools and there was more curriculum guidance about mental health, it would set a good tone. Michael's point about CPD is very well made because of the rural challenges. I think, however, teacher training, one of my colleagues in SAMH does an R a term for some of the teacher training colleges on mental health, and that's not really enough for the fourth year students, so something that could be considered.
Yeah.
In terms of support for children on the autistic spectrum, I think there's a lot of positive developments in how we support children, and they can make a huge difference really at virtually no cost, and that's in terms of spreading ideas about intensive behavioural support for families. We've got two services in Scotland, they're both in NHS Lothian, which provide positive behavioural support to families. And it's something that's being really promoted within adult care of people with learning disability and autism. And it can really mean that you prevent the very much higher level cost of inpatient care.
Thank you to the panel for coming along this morning, and I'm sure we're going to find out some really valuable information from you. I was interested in a point that you were making there, Sophie, about inpatient beds and development inpatient services, because obviously the focus of health at the moment is about developing community services as opposed to reprovisioning and inpatient services. And I'm aware that there is already a children's inpatient unit in the Sick Children's Hospital in Glasgow, and I wonder if you'd be able to comment on the use of the beds there and if if it's been considered that, that perhaps some of the bedtime there might be used for more specialist areas of child and adolescent mental health.
Yep, the provision at the Glasgow Hospital has a very good reputation, but it's for support of children under 12 years. So obviously it's predominantly in the teenage years that children and young people experience mental health. And we have at present 3 inpatient units across Scotland.
Yes, yeah.
For adolescents. The issue is that those provisions are not suited to children with learning disability or autism. So in the last...
So when we're talking about children, then what age are we talking about? Because I suppose I'm maybe mm-hmm. confusing children, yes, with adolescents.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we don't have any provision that's specific to learning disability and autism, yes, basically, for any child under the age of 18 or young person, yeah. The Glasgow Hospital does have some expertise in that area.
Yes.
Over the last 5 years, they've been, according to records, and it's probably an underestimate, around 85 children who've either had to be accommodated in adult wards or sent down south. So it's not the case that they are being treated in the community. They're actually inpatients, but they're very inappropriately treated. And as a result, they end up being very, very long time in hospital at great cost. And, you know, we've seen examples where children or young people are in generic young people's units, one of the 3 young people's units, and their mental health deteriorates dramatically. If they're transferred to a unit that's appropriate to, has an autism understanding and environment, literally within days, they're beginning a process of recovery, and those children can be, you know, after a very long time, returned back to the community support services. But it's really detrimental to their own health, and it's at great cost if children are sent down south to provision.
So sorry, just for clarification, so I've got this right in my own head. So what when you're talking about, you're talking about adolescents as opposed to children when you're talking about the children that you're talking about with a specific disorders, a specific illnesses?
Yes, over 12. So there's very little incident of that really extreme level of need for inpatient care in the under 12s. Right. And at present in Scotland, we have a national provision in Glasgow, which has a very high level of expertise and is well regarded.
So is the issue then with the level of training with the current inpatient staff and the adolescent mental health units, if you're saying that mm-hmm. sometimes these adolescents are admitted there and the environment's not suitable?
That's right. There's just a sort of difference between provision which is suited to children with autism and children who have severe mental health issues and require inpatient. So those would be children who are bipolar or who have eating disorders or who have extreme anxiety or depression and self-harm. So those are the generic provision. Those children require, you know, the 3 services that we have across Scotland. But what we don't have is, for children with autism, you need a very, very highly structured environment, and you need psychiatrists and CAMHS teams who are specialists to that. And we do have those, we do have a very high level of specialist knowledge in Scotland. And, you know, what would be advantageous about having a service would be that, and what's proposed is that we then have dissemination of that expertise to the health board, so that the experience and the support from those professionals could be disseminated to the community CAMHS teams. So we would then be really trying to prevent as much as possible the need for inpatient care, because obviously inpatient care is very distressing. It's the last thing you want, but you need it for any sector of the community. And at present, we have inpatient care for all sectors of community. The one that we don't have is for children with learning disability. And the Scottish Government itself has sort of cited that as a discrimination against those children.
So, to be absolutely clear, between 12 and 18, was that what you said there?
Yes, that's
So between 12 and 18, we currently have no provision, inpatient provision, for those who need it, for children and adolescents with learning disabilities who require that level of inpatient care.
So it's another way of putting it, we have no secure inpatient psychiatric care. The children who require secure care are those with such extreme challenging behaviour that they're either an extreme danger to themselves or they're a danger to the public. And those children, that very small group of children. And so what we need in Scotland is to be able to say we can care for any child. There's no child that needs to be sent away because their psychiatric needs are such that they can't be cared for within Scotland. And that group would include children with a forensic background with psychiatric need, children with extreme challenging behaviour generally because they have autism, and children who have, you know, impaired understanding, so they have learning disabilities. So it's that very small extreme.
Thank you, that's very helpful. Miles, then Alison.
Vina, I just wanted to pick up on Claire's point regarding yesterday. I visited the Edinburgh Crisis Centre, which is run by Penumbra, and one of the issues they had was that they can only take referrals from people over the age of 18, yet they have capacity, and actually it could be quite an appropriate service for those between 16 and 18 years old. Does the panel agree that actually breaking down people maybe above 16 would be a more appropriate way of looking at this? And in young people or children, do you not actually feel that a more appropriate situation would be an intensive at-home nurse service to provide support so these young people aren't being taken out of their homes and communities?
In short, I think that issues around self-harm are not being well catered for young people. We know from the Scottish Health Survey that there are higher rates of detection of self-harm, especially amongst young women, recently. And what we think and are calling for is for professionals who interact with young people, whether that's GPs, teachers, youth workers, to receive the training to respond appropriately if they discover or if a young person approaches them to say that they are trying to cope with their mental health problems by self-harming. And given the sensitivities of that and how unwell that young person may be, it has to be done in a way, which is why we call for the training. We know that the onset of mental health problems in adolescents tends to start around 14, and you can see through the research that young people's self-esteem and confidence often takes a dip from 14, 15 onwards. So having a much earlier access to treatment, to support, would be very appropriate and desirable. I think from the point of view of an at-home nurse service, where that is possible, absolutely. The Mental Welfare Commission published their Young People's Monitoring Report a few weeks ago, which showed that there's been a decrease in the number of young people who've been held, have been supported on adult wards in the last year, from 207 down to 135. Now, this is still too high a number for those very unwell young people, but they attributed some of the decrease both to an increase of beds in Dundee, but also to the much more wraparound multidisciplinary support at home in the community. So I think that's to be welcomed, and it'd be good to see more of that.
Just to explain why children need inpatient care for acute treatment, partly because of, in some circumstances, their behaviour is so extreme. So, you know, for example, the other siblings might be at risk. Sometimes they don't sleep, they're violent, their behaviour is extremely antisocial. So it's actually the family breaks down under those circumstances. It's sort of intolerable. So it's partly the extremeness of that, but it's also that you need sometimes to be able to take that young person out of that environment into a clinical environment so that you can assess, and generally that assessment is for 3 months to be able to assess what disorders are going on there so that you can appropriately treat.
Just on your first point about lowering it to 16, one of the things that came out of our research is a lot of young people and adolescents sort of felt that a transition service between sort of the ages 16 to 18 up to 24 would probably be beneficial. So I'm wondering if rather than just simply lowering the bar to 16, it might be worth trying to create a bespoke service within the NHS that focuses on tailoring them through that sort of transition period, and then trying to get the third sector working with TSIs and IGBs to try and get a linked up approach where that's mirrored throughout.
Can I just for clarification, Sophie, if I may, do you believe that young people with neurodevelopmental disorders are best treated within the CAMHS framework, are best diagnosed and treated within the framework that exists in CAMHS, or are you looking for something else?
I personally think they have to be, really, because it just has to be within a very sort of consistent framework, and it is a medical diagnosis. So it's no good just be. But I think what's a problem is people not identifying when actually the signs are very evident, and then as other people have said earlier, you know, that when they are referred, it takes a very, very long time for diagnosis.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. My next question, I'll perhaps address this to Michael. We know that, certainly several studies have indicated that adolescent girls in Scotland particularly suffer from poor mental health. I just wondered if perhaps Michael and Rachel could suggest why they think this might be the case and what we're doing to tackle that.
Well, there's part of our research was about how some young girls felt that they weren't really taken seriously with poor mental health. So if a young girl says, "I feel depressed," perhaps the response is going to be, "Are you on your period? Do you need a tampon?" And that's a social structure that I think needs to be addressed somehow. But I think as well, practitioners need to be able to take young girls and adolescents more seriously, so that early intervention can come in, rather than it sort of being suppressed. Nobody will take me seriously until self-harm and more severe issues come out. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you want to add anything.
Absolutely. Some of the research has been done through the Children and Adolescents Health Research Unit at St Andrews on the health behaviour of school age children, looking at the mental well-being and emotional resilience of young people, looking at rates of depression. And as I say, if you look across the board, at the age of 13, boys and girls tend to be fairly even. Going to 15, boys seem to still be quite, I'm using my hands, which is not going to be very helpful for the official report, but however, but 15-year-old girls see a drop in their mental well-being. Although there's a general drop, but there's a sharper drop for young women. The researchers have posited that this is due to exam pressure, or that young women seem to feel more distressed about the pressure of exams. Mm-hmm. Impacts around social media and body image are certainly things too that have an impact on their mental health and well-being. It's really hard to tell, you know, because we know that there are protective factors around peer issues and positive feelings about school. Whenever there's negative feelings about school and must pass these exams or my life will be finished, mm-hmm. you know, then that is not really very helpful. Mm-hmm. In terms of making things better, I think it's teaching young people to cope and to become more resilient and be able to face with what life throws at you, as well as rather than just saying, here's how to cope with exam pressure, it's more about here's how to deal with everything, and then the exam pressure may not be as much.
Can I ask one? A lot of the written submissions focus on rejected referrals, mm-hmm. and there seems to be different views about why they might be rejected. Mm-hmm. Some organisations suggest they might be rejected because it'll make waiting times increase. Others suggest they might be rejected because they were inappropriate in the first place and could mm-hmm. perhaps have been picked up by tier one or two. Mm-hmm. Do you have any views on whether we need to review the way we refer? Any views on that evidence at all?
I think certainly a wide review about how we refer, how tier one, anyone who is approached by a young person about their mental health we would hope that GPs or teachers are equipped enough to recognise that, you know, this young person in front of them needs some support and they need some fast support for it, you know, in terms of whether the referrals are inappropriate or whether there is a waiting time gaming going on and not wanting to increase the waiting lists. It's really hard to tell without a review because we simply don't know how many young people are coming forward at a tier one stage asking for support. And as Michael said, getting an inappropriate response about you're a teenager, you'll grow out of it, it's puberty, it's your period, something like that for young women. Or if they are simply seeing CAMHS as something that begins at tier three. And I think universal services need to be able to cope with the mental health of children and young people as it's presented to them.
One of the other points that came up in our research was about how maybe resources are very stretched. So, for example, school counsellors, quotes we've got, my school counsellor has a waiting list of 170 people. Counselling sessions are infrequent. You have to be put on a list and wait months to see the school psychologist. It's not good. So when you have issues like that inside a school, where the school feels it can't cope with the young person, they're naturally going to want to refer onwards. Whether or not they would have the capacity to deal with that issue, they might not have the resources. As for meeting waiting time targets, this isn't in the research. This has been since I've had some practitioners coming to me talking about it, saying how they've had reports of young people basically being handed information pamphlets for their first meeting and then sent on their way as a way of kind of dodging that first waiting time target. So I'm not convinced necessarily that it would all be focused on waiting times. It might be a part of it, but there are other ways that you could just get around that if you didn't want to flag it up in a system. It's maybe more about the two. Tier 3 doesn't have the number of CPNs to support the young people. Mm-hmm. Tier 1 doesn't have the training or the resources to provide the staff that do have the training to support them, and they're kind of bouncing off each other.
I think the other challenge is that the waiting time target is only a snapshot of the access point into CAMHS, but we don't actually know what happens after a young person goes into CAMHS. You know, we don't know how long they wait in between appointments. We don't know what community support they're receiving. We don't know if at the end, once they turn 18, if they feel that they have made a recovery or if they are moving into adult services and what impact moving into adult services is having on their mental health. So I think the picture that we have is quite patchy and not quite good enough from our point of view. The young people we've spoken to have not been terribly happy about their experiences, whether they are within the CAMHS system, having been assessed as requiring that more severe support, or if they're amongst the 6,000 a year who are being rejected in their rejected referrals and then are left with nowhere to go. You know, their GP or someone has said, you need additional support. The more specialist support come back and say, no, you don't. And they're in no man's land. And everyone has mental health. And those young people are not being serviced.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Marie?
Meenor, can I ask you specifically about the age of eligibility for CAMHS services? So we had a little bit of discussion there around whether people should be able to access more adult services at the age of 16. My experience of working in psychiatry was that I had concerns about people coming into adult services at the age of 16 when they're still, frankly, I mean, I think some young people are still vulnerable right up to late teens, early 20s, and probably an adult psychiatric hospital isn't the most appropriate place for them to be cared for. I also saw when I worked in psychiatry, people who, in Highland certainly, there was a decision made over whether you were still in full-time education, and that was how the judgment was made on whether you qualified for CAMHS services or adult services. And I think the difficulty I had with that was that I saw many people who had very, very severe illness, which meant that they had come out of education, but they needed to go back in. And then because they were then in adult services, they didn't have access to the specialist support to get them back into education. And I think, you know, mental illness at any age is hard enough, but mental illness at a time when it really disrupts your potential to fulfil your educational you know, ability is it can have a really devastating impact on the rest of your life. Just wondered what you all thought.
Sorry, it was just a point when you said adults at 16 services. What I think young people have said very clearly is they need their own service, not to go up to adult services. I think that would be inappropriate, and I think that some CAMHS units are actually trying to do a sort of bridging service because there are issues with you suddenly turn 18 and you know the waiting time till you're seen by a CPN triples, and you're moving away from school, your friends have all left to university, you're expected to either get a job, go into university, or you end up in a benefit system, which can be quite stressful. So it's not about putting them into an adult service, it's about creating one more bespoke for the issues that they're likely to face at that transitional period.
Sam Hitch has called for a review of the age at which people can access CAMHS, and we think that if young people are vulnerable and they need that additional support, then stopping CAMHS support at 16 in some health boards or at 18 in others is not appropriate, and they should continue to receive the specialist support up until they're 25. We know that brain development continues until they're 25, so it follows that, and it follows the Children and Young People's Act, which looked at how vulnerable people should receive support beyond their 18th birthday. You're right about the NHS boards. There's a cut-off point about 16 in places like Dumfries and Galloway, in Lanarkshire, in Shetland, if those young people are not in full-time education, and Tayside, I think, and also Ayrshire and Arran as well. So there are many, it's something that the NHS has said, we want CAMHS to be provided to 18. Those health boards are working hard, I think, to achieve that. That also has an implication on the pool of young people who would be going forward and eligible for CAMHS support. I was speaking to a young woman on Friday who's been receiving support from SAMH since she was 16 when she was referred to CAMHS. And she's now 20, so she's been in children's services for 2 years and now in adult services for 2 years. And she said when she hit 18, that was the end. And it was like dropping off a cliff, basically, because she'd built up a relationship with her CAMHS nurse over 2 years. She felt that she was making some progress. She'd had a very difficult time when she was 17, when she was actually detained in a mixed adult ward, which was a terrifying experience for her. But she had made some progress, and when she hit 18, that was it. And she was into adult services. There was no transition between adult or between children's and adult services. There was no discussion really with her. She knew it was coming, but she didn't really. It wasn't made clear to her what it would mean for her support. The approach taken by adult services was totally different from the children's services. So she felt that everything she'd been doing with her clinicians for 2 years beforehand was a bit of a waste of time from her. You know, she was very angry about the way she felt she'd been treated, because she felt that there was no continuity, there was no logic in the situation. She was just suddenly abandoned to adult services, and she didn't have that kind of support that she felt that she needed. And she's still a very vulnerable young woman. She's only 20. From that point of view, we do think, you know, there needs to be an extension and a much more specialised service for young adults, because I think if mental health problems are developing at this stage and they can receive consistent levels of support as young people are developing into adulthood, then they're much more likely to make a recovery, because what Jessica told me was that she actually took a setback when she went into adult services, and she felt very challenged by the new system, and it set her back when, you know, she could have, if she'd had a wee bit more of a transition and joined up approach, she might have been able to accept things a bit further on, and she might have been a bit further on where she is now.
So just adding to that, it also has a fairly harsh effect on young people waiting to go into the system. So if your mental illness isn't diagnosed until you're, say, 16, 17, and then you're told that you're on a waiting list, and then at the end of the waiting list, you go into an adult service, and then you're on a completely new waiting list, completely different times. You have to wait for that to to take you through into an adult service, that can have quite a powerful feeling of not being wanted or feeling like nobody's taking you seriously. One quote I have from a young person is, I'm on a waiting list for CAMHS. I've been told that I'm waiting for them to hire a new psychiatrist. They've told me I'll be waiting around 8 to 10 months. I'm nearly 18, so I bet I'll get passed on again. So if young people are feeling like that, that the system is just viewing them as a number to get passed on, you can imagine what sort of effect that's going to have on the mental health of someone who's already at tier three in terms of mental health, and how much more difficult it is going on their road to recovery. And it's something to be aware of. It's not just the people in the system it affects, it's the people waiting to get into the system too.
Thank you.
Claire?
Thank you for coming, if you let me come in here. I just wanted to make a comment, actually, about, I'm aware that certainly in Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS, they changed their transition from adult mental health services into older adult mental health services, and now that's much more needs-led. So there's no longer a cut-off that at 65, your care is then automatically transferred over. So it's interesting that some health boards, and I'm not sure if it's across the country, have already acknowledged that at that end of our lives, it's not particularly helpful for your care to be transferred over to another service.
I wonder if I could raise the issue of health inequality. It's one of the issues that this committee has said is one of our priorities. And I want to pick up on the issue, it's the only analogy I can have, is with dyslexia. And in my own area, in one of the poorest, comparing one of the poorest areas and one of the most affluent areas, the level of identification of an issue like dyslexia is much higher in the affluent area than it is in the poorer area. Now, I can't make that analogy with a mental health problem, but what I want to ask is, are you finding similar things with mental health issues? For example, a diagnosis of autism or ADHD or something like that, where in affluent areas the diagnosis is happening quicker and there are higher rates of diagnosis than there are in areas of multiple deprivation?
I'd actually say no. We run our postcodes through the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation, and we're more likely to support families in areas quintiles 1 and 2, which are the higher areas of social deprivation. It's interesting that almost all our projects, those are the highest, and then it drops off with the middle, and then quintile 5 again rises a bit, but we disproportionately provide our support to families in very high areas of deprivation. I know that goes against what most people believe to be the case, but my experience is that families are really desperate to support their children, and they go to huge lengths. And I think one of the things we're sort of missing is that parents are such a huge resource, and actually they come away from the treatment and the support feeling very belittled and demoralised. I think it's one of the reasons families come to our service a lot, is they've felt criticised, they've felt that they're being told their child's condition is to do with their parenting. Whereas actually if you look at the sort of evidence, you can see that, you could almost see it as sort of statistical. Of course, there'll be children with extreme needs in all, across all sectors of the community.
Yeah. And the rest of the panel want to comment on that?
I mean, I think there are very definite trends amongst looked after children who have, higher rates of poor mental health. I think it's a variety of trends, really. You've got some young women from less deprived areas seem to be feeling under more pressure about their mental health during their adolescence than other demographics. So it's quite a mixed picture.
In terms of following that through to the issue of inappropriate referrals and, under-reporting, over-reporting, what can we do about that? What can be done about the nature of people, inappropriate referrals, and whether we are under-reporting or over-reporting?
I think it comes back to education. I think children and young people need to be supported from an early age about how to look after their mental health and to look for signs about poor mental health and asking for help at an early stage. There are duties on public services in Scotland through the Children and Young People's Act to have regard to the UNCRC, which is all about listening to children and young people, basically, and listening to their opinions and informing their decisions and making sure that there's an ask once, get help fast approach, really. I think children, a young person doesn't wake up, go to bed on a Monday night and then wake up the next day and need tier three CAMHS. We need to move backwards and start thinking about how we can help young people at an earlier stage, give them the confidence to ask for help and appropriately respond to them when they do.
One of the points that's came up in our research is PSHE being failing young people effectively. It's patchwork at best. I don't think it's been updated since 2008, though please don't quote me. It has been several years either way, and it does predate Curriculum for Excellence. If ever an organisation approaches Education Scotland, the response is invariably, well, that's down to local authorities and down to individual schools. So you get quite a remarkable patchwork of how much support is offered and how much mental health training is available. So there was one young person who said that they had one session on mental health in the 6 years that they were in school through that, and that's then you get other young people that say that actually it didn't show up in PSHE. That was about how do you write applications to get into university, how do you write application forms. There isn't enough about how do we build young people's resilience and make sure that they're able to survive outside of a school environment, and how do they survive in that school environment, how do they deal with exam pressure. Anecdotally, my speaking to a local CAMHS worker says that she gets about two times as many referrals when it's coming up for exam period, self-harm, anxiety and stress, just because so many young people are crumbling under the pressure we're putting them under. The schools in that sort of catchment area don't have as good a PSHE as perhaps you would hope for. So it's maybe worth linking up with the Education Lifelong Learning Committee, looking at how do we develop that into PSHE guidance. How do we try and get inspected in schools? How do we make sure that there is a universal standard that is being met that will try and build young people's resilience so that it doesn't happen as much, and then that at the very least they're able to recognise in themselves this is a point where I should ask for help, and they're confident enough to do so.
Said I would try and keep the time for people. Does anyone else want to come in at this point? Alison, very briefly.
Yeah, just a very, very quick question. Many submissions indicate that demand outstrips the capacity of the service, and I think that is coming across in your evidence, but the British Psychological Society state that just 0.46 of the NHS budget is spent on CAMHS. Just wondering if you were aware of that and if you feel that this is an area that requires greater investment.
It's 0.46 and then of mental health services, I think it's 5.81 is spent on CAMHS. So children are really losing out in terms of the proportion of spend. And actually that's just, where's the early intervention there? Surely we should be investing in children and young people. A psychiatrist described it to me like a plane taking off. You know, that young person is developing so fast, and during the adolescent years, they're learning the resilience and the skills that they need for later life. So if they're really sort of taken out of the picture by mental health during that time, they're not going to recapture those skills. So I think, it's a would be a really positive investment if we put more resources into child and adolescent. Thank you.
Eager for the mic. One of the things that came to occur to me as you're saying that is Maureen Watt said that the government was investing £150 million into mental health over the next 5 years. And that sounds impressive, but when you break that down, that's £30 million a year. There are 32 local authorities, so that's about £900,000 per. 8 priorities in the strategy, so that's about 115,000 per. So for children and young people, that would be 115,000, assuming that it was an equal distribution per local authority. Rural areas, the Western Isles won't probably get as much as Glasgow, for example. Mm-hmm. So I think that statistic, I didn't know it, it doesn't surprise me, because when we say mental health has this much, when you actually start chipping away and breaking down how much is ring-fenced for youth services, it's not actually that much. I think the big headline figure is what we hear, and there isn't as much looking at how much can that actually afford for young people. 115,000 is what, maybe 3 CPNs, tier 3 per region, if that.
I think it's very hard to put a price on how much you should be spending on CAMHS until you actually fully evaluate what the demand for CAMHS is, because, you know, it's one of these limitless amounts at the moment, you know, because we don't actually know how many young people are seeking help from tier 1 and tier 3 services, because the measurement is starting at the tier 3 end of things. I think we know that the Scottish Government has increased investment over the past few years and have earmarked 54 million for CAMHS over the next few years. Some of that is already attributed, or it's been set aside for certain spending in terms of workforce development and service re-delivery and evaluation. But I think we need a wider review, basically, because then we can actually put a price on what we need to spend. We would very much want some of the funding to be targeted at the early stages, because I think that you can increase the workforce, you can increase the supply side of things, and there have been improvements in the volume of staff working in Scotland. We're now at almost 18.2 per 100,000, and I think the goal is 20 per 100,000 of CAMHS staff. But until you actually start, you know, helping young people to manage their mental health and recognise it, the demand for services is not going to dry up, and all the supply in the world is not going to actually be able to meet the demand. So I think we just need a wider review so that we can fully evaluate the need and start supporting young people the first time they ask for help.
Thank you.
Okay, can I thank the panel very much for their evidence this morning. We will have another session on CAMHS next week, and then we'll have a session on adult mental health and a further session with the Minister for Mental Health later in the month. As agreed previously, we'll now move into private session. Thank you very much.